I forgot to do like a proper intro. Now that I'm in the zone. I hate doing YouTube videos. I'm not a good speaker. I'm usually the one behind the camera, but you know, I figured I'll start doing this since everyone else is a content creator now.
My name is Brendan. Welcome to Street Grain. I'm gonna show you what's inside my camera bag for 2021. I filmed an entire what's in my camera bag, but I realized the audio was terrible, so we've got like a whole new setup. Hopefully this works out better. Let's get started. Here it is. This is the Billingham bag. It's made in England. Great bag, I just got this. I used to use the Domkey bags, but I found they were way too small for what I was trying to carry with me. This is great for if you want to carry around a camera, a lens, notebooks, extra film. Domkey, I was lucky if I could fit my camera and some extra film. Couldn't bring two lenses. This is a great bag for travel if you're into traveling. Plus, it looks nice. Looks very sexy. If we open it up, kind of messy, but still looks pretty good. First things first, of course, is the Leica M4P. Just got this summer. Gorgeous camera, built like a tank. Made in Canada, surprisingly, not Germany. With the commercial failure of the Leica M5, they came out with the M4II and the M4P, which practically saved the company, so they say. I went with an earlier model. It's the brass top model, mainly because I wanted something robust like the original M4. M6s tend to suffer from zinc oxidation and rotting of the metal. So if there were to be a scratch and get salt water or something on there, it will start to deteriorate the metal. So a brass top will avoid that. The lens attached is a Voigtlander 35 f1.4. Multi-coated. Right about the single coating and multi-coating differences, there's really none in my opinion. Unless you were to take this lens and shoot digital, then it would make sense. But it wide open, it's still pretty soft, but it's a all-around great lens. It's robust, it's sharp, it's accurate, it's very lightweight. It's a great all-around lens. I totally recommend if you're a first-time Leica buyer. This lens is great. On the Leica itself is a Camera Craft all metal hand grip with a built-in Arca Swiss and tripod mount right on the bottom there. This is a great grip if you have large hands like I do. It just makes holding it a lot more comfortable when you're walking around. And using larger lenses, you get a really nice, tight grip, and it feels robust in your hands. It carries 4 extra batteries, so I'm never afraid that my meter will go dead on me. I have extra batteries right in the grip itself. Up on top is the VC Meter 2 by Voigtlander. Very expensive for what it does. It literally is just a spot meter. It just gives you an average readout right on top. You have your shutter speed and your aperture. So you just turn these until you get an accurate reading, and the light will turn green once it's perfect. I've never had a problem with it. When I'm taking a reading, I'll just get my highlights and then I'll get my shadows and then I'll just remember what f-stops it gave me. Another handy feature is the lines. I don't know if you can see it. There's black lines in between each of the aperture readings. that correlate with the shutter speed, so you can quickly change your settings just by looking at those lines. Really handy tool. The reason I bought the M4P was mainly I didn't want to spend an extra $1,500 just to get an M6, because I already had the VC2 meter. There was no reason for me to get an M6. Maybe later down the road if I want like a pure German Leica, but I'm not a purist, so whatever works for you, it works. I haven't run into any problems. You seal a Leica, it lasts you 5+ years, and then get it CLA'd again, keep shooting. These things last forever. Another cool thing about the M4P is the frame lines. Inside the viewfinder, you have frame lines for 28 mil, 35, 50, 75, it goes on and on. Some people hate that there's so many frame lines, so they purposely cover up the little diffractor window there and just get rid of them, but I don't mind it. I don't really care. As long as I have my visual guide for 35 and 50, I'm good. Up next is the Canon 50mm f1.2. This is a fabulous lens. I just got this. Huge, fast aperture. Incredibly sharp, wide open. These were made back in the 50s for the Canon 7 series, the Canon P rangefinder series. At the time, it was the fastest lens ever created from Canon. They've also created the Dream lens. It's a 0.95 aperture. That one's the fastest, but a little soft. This one's pretty sharp, wide open. I actually have the Americanized version, so it shows my distance scale in feet. If you have the European or Japanese versions, they'll have the meters, but this one says feet. I thought that was a nice little quirk. Pretty heavy and pretty hard to focus, so I added this little focus tab. I don't know if they still make these. You probably find these on eBay, but it just makes holding it a lot better when you're focusing. Just like the other smaller lenses that have been built in. These just give it an extra grip. This uses the Leica LTM to M-mount adapter. And basically this allows you to use your LTM lenses on a Leica M body. And when you attach this lens to your Leica M body, yeah, the frame lines will change. Just make sure you get one that says 50-75 if you buy an adapter for a 50mm lens or a 75mm lens. They have different adapters for different lenses, so just make sure you get the right one so your frame lines are accurate. I guess next would be film. I currently use this gorgeous Kodak case. They just released these. Kind of pricey, about like $30 for this, but it's all metal, and you open it up, holds 5 rolls. I used to use the Japan Camera Hunter ones, but I found that my lids were falling off when I would pull it out of my bag, and I didn't want all my film to fall out with it, so this one's great, because I can just make sure it's nice and secure. Little hack for what I do inside the cap is I'll put strips of tape, just paper tape or painter's tape, whatever, just so you can mark what film you're using. And I just use a Sharpie and I'll write down like HP5 400, whatever ISO I'm shooting at, I'll write that down. That way, if my meter, I don't mark it on my meter, it goes out, I'm not forgetting what I shot my film on. The main film I use is Ilford HP5. And I've shot enough Kodak Tri-X, T-Max, all those different films. I used to shoot Arista too, because it was cheap. But I found Ilford, for my style, works really well. I use Rodinal. I've been using Rodinal for the last 5 years. Ilford and Rodinal just work together. And the scans, just it feels like you printed it in a darkroom. Kodak Tri-X, I found, was too muddy. The shadows were hard to recover when you're scanning with Kodak Tri-X, and with HP5 it's a little more it's lifted, it feels lifted, the shadows. The highlights too, you can retain a lot of information with Ilford HP5 Plus. I rarely shoot color. If I do, I'll usually go for a Portra 160 or 400. I've shot 800, but I rarely ever shoot that high of an ISO unless I'm pushing black and white. I'm just not really a color fan. I hate developing it. It's expensive to develop too. And I don't know. I guess I'm just gonna experiment more with color, but I love black and white and the craft of black and white. When I'm walking around, I'll usually use one of these, and it basically attaches to your belt, and it's waterproof, it's protected, it's hard plastic, and it carries two rolls of film. But what I usually do is I'll fill one side with film, and then the other side I'll usually fill a little like survival kit. So it's got extra batteries in there, and it's also got some wipes, you know, in case my lens gets dirty. And usually I'll carry this around instead of my big bag, so I don't have to lug around the bag, especially if you're, you know, running around, you don't want to have to carry a bag or worry about someone stealing this off you. So find whatever works for you. I've gone through different versions of this. I used to have a cloth one, but one time I sat down, it bent one of my cans of film, so that was kind of why I got this heavy plastic one. What else? Business cards. You always want to carry on business cards. You never know when someone asks for your Instagram handle or your information, or if I take a picture of someone and they want it, I can always have them just email me and quickly get that out to them once I develop the film. So invest in a good card too, because you get those like cheapo ones. I don't know what people use anymore, but these are called like social cards, and they're just little like 2x2 inch square cards with my information. And very, very useful, especially when you're networking. Usually I'll use this mini tripod. This is a Manfrotto mini tripod. I don't know the exact model, but I'll add it in the description. Very useful. You just put this in your bag and you got a quick solution for shooting like night scenes if something pops up. Another cool thing is this little miniature shutter release. And usually I'll use this in conjunction with the tripod and make sure I get a nice stable image. Very compact and useful. Totally recommend. Filters. These are important. I don't know, you probably noticed on all my lenses right now, instead of a UV protector, I will use a yellow filter. And more specifically, it's the yellow number 8. It has a exposure compensation of at least one stop. And what a yellow filter does is just adds an extra punch of contrast. Interesting how it works. Like, you add contrast in Lightroom, you could sort of tell it was manipulated using filters on your lenses when you're shooting. It's definitely a more organic bump of contrast after you scan. And with Rodinal, I've noticed you get these deep, contrasty, detailed shadows. I don't know how to describe it. You just have to see it to believe it. But I have filters for each of my lenses, the 50 and the 35. The 35 takes 43 millimeter filters. And then the 50 millimeter takes your generic 55 millimeter filters. Another really great filter I use is a red 25. The red 25 has a exposure compensation of at least 3 stops. And what this does, it adds dark contrast to blues, and it makes red objects just pop, sort of like white, but great for like dramatic skies if you're doing a landscape or, you know, you want something to pop. You slap a red filter on and it looks really cool. Filters with a rangefinder are so much easier than filters on a SLR or through the lens system. With a rangefinder, you're not looking through the lens, you're looking through a viewfinder, so you're able to leave the filters on without hindering your ability to focus. So these are really fun just to like leave on your lenses and forget about them and just have fun shooting. That's the whole point. I've struggled in the past using SLRs and filters. Like you use a red filter and it's just awful. It doesn't work out that well. Because you can't see when you're trying to focus, especially in a dark setting. With a rangefinder, it's just a bright viewfinder and your focus patch and that's it. There's no hindrance. Wipes. I have way too many wipes. These are great. They're just single use, individually wrapped, no mess, no bottle of solution for lens cleaning. I just put like a handful of these in my bag and throw them away when I'm done. It's great when you're in a rush and you don't want to spend too much time cleaning your lenses. With those, I also use the lens pen. And the lens pen is mainly just for cleaning up extra smudges that my lens wipes don't pick up. So I'll use this end on my filters and just make sure they're super clean before I start shooting. It also has like a little brush. These are great just for on the go. You just throw them in your bag. Another important thing is Sharpies. Definitely recommend carrying around a few Sharpies. Just for marking down your film types, and marking the tape, or if you have a notebook, or you can even like mark your business cards with like extra information for that person that you hand it to. Definitely carry on Sharpies. Speaking of writing, have a notebook. I carry on field notes. I've had field notes for the last 10 years. I can't get away from them. They're expensive, but they work. And this is just your thoughts, your ideas, your dreams. I typically draw out projects I've worked on or will work on, or lighting diagrams I want to use in the future. I also carry around my specialty cards if I'm, you know, trying to network with other people. I have these cards that just have my pictures and my information on the back. I carry those in this because it's a little nicer. And then I use this Fisher Space Pen just so I know it's, you know, it's gonna write upside down, it's gonna write underwater in case you never know. You never know. If I go to space, I'm set. But just find what works for you. This has always worked for me. I've never had a problem. I asked a few questions over on my Instagram and I got a few responses. The one that really struck me was most overrated professional used film. And I guess they're asking which film is the most overrated that people use. And I want to say it's Kodak Portra. Not because of the film particularly, more because of how people use that film. A lot of people shoot Kodak Portra the way it wasn't designed. I've noticed when they shoot Portra, they just shoot at box speed. So they just shoot at 400. They don't do anything else. They meter for 400, develop at 400. It's okay, but iPhone cameras are starting to become way better than, you know, a professional camera. And if you shoot Portra at 400, it's gonna look like a generic photograph you took like with an iPhone. That's just my personal opinion. Portra was designed to shoot overexposed. You can literally meter for the shadows and be three stops overexposed and you'd still have information when you develop it. A lot of people will meter for the shadows and push their film to its limits. I've shot Portra 400 at like ISO 50 and still got some really cool images. Don't be afraid to you know, explore with film and get a little crazy. It's film after all. You're not shooting digital. Don't be afraid to like improvise with film. You know, you're shooting film after all. If you want to be exact, shoot digital. Film, you have more of a leeway when it comes to like exploring and trying new things. So definitely don't be afraid to just explore. Someone once asked me, how do you justify the cost of film? And I think the simplest way to answer that is it's not about the cost, it's about the craft. I don't care how much I spend on the film. I know it's gonna be expensive. I know the chemicals are gonna be expensive. But since I develop it myself, I scan it myself, I shoot it myself, it's the whole craft. It's like a routine. It's almost like a religious experience. You know, you load your film, you shoot it, take it out, load the tank, develop it, pour the fixer in, let it dry, scan it. It's a whole production. It's almost like a spiritual, you know, experience when you're working with film. It forces you to care more about your subject and what you're photographing, rather than getting tied up on costs and what you're shooting with and what lens you're using, what camera you're using. You shouldn't even be thinking about that. You should be thinking about what the content is and what you're trying to share with the rest of the world, what vision you're trying to show people. If you get too wrapped up in what other people are using as far as like film, cameras, lenses, you start to lose touch of the value of photography and what you're trying to share with the world. You want your pictures to speak for themselves. So just don't worry about it and just shoot. You know, nobody cares if you shoot Leica, nobody cares if you shoot a cheapo Canon, you know, as long as the pictures turn out and as long as your story is being shared, that's all that matters. Anyway, thanks for joining me. I hope this was somewhat helpful for people, you know, looking to see what system will work for them. This is just how I've been shooting the last year. I bought the Leica last summer during COVID. 2020 was a rough year, not a lot to do. So you get bored searching on eBay and looking for cameras, and the M4P, I don't know. It looked like a camera I would enjoy, and I've definitely been enjoying it. It's definitely worth the cost. You know it will last you. It'll probably outlive you if you take care of it. It's definitely an investment piece, and there are more expensive versions out there that are definitely investment pieces, but at least you know that that camera is gonna work for you. It's gonna be on your side 24/7. Maybe not 24/7, but it's definitely gonna go with you everywhere. I've gone through a phase where I've carried around large cameras, big lenses, you know, but that's all street cred. You're just trying to show off for the next guy looking at you. You know, someone has like lens envy, they're staring at that lens. I didn't get that. I tried it. It's just heavy. I want something that works with me and it works for me and it gets my vision across. And for me, that was the Leica. If you like this video, make sure to like, subscribe, share it. I don't know. I'm not here for the money. I don't care if anyone watches this. But if you have any questions, please let me know. And make sure to follow me on my Instagram at streetgrain with 2 underscores in between streetgrain. I'll put the links in the descriptions of all the stuff I talked about. And I hope you have a good one. I'll see you in the next video.